So I wanted to briefly introduce somebody at this point who needs no introduction to our faculty and residents, because he's been with us all week long doing just an outstanding job. Dr. Bennett Leventhal is world-renowned in the field of autism, ADHD, and bullying, and he and his wife, Dr. Youngshin Kim, have really provided quite an education for our trainees, our faculty, and for the general public. He's devoted years of passionate work, working with children, received many, many awards. He is currently, let me serve my glasses.
It's okay.
He's a professor of child and adolescent psychiatry at New York University's Child Study Center, as well as deputy director of the Nathan Klein Institute for Psychiatric Research. So let me introduce a man who needs no introduction, Dr. Bennett Leventhal.
Thanks, Jeff. Thank you. I've got to find the clicker. Here it is. So first of all, it's a real privilege to be here. I must say I'm particularly thrilled to be in the presence of a number of friends who I've known for years, but especially Uli, who was a wonderful colleague at the University of Chicago with me many years ago, and one of my really most admired colleagues, and you're very lucky to have him here. So thank you for coming, Uli. So today I'm going to talk about autism spectrum disorders and things I've learned in the process of my work over the years. So I'm going to go through a series of lessons learned. But I want you not to think about this as just related to autism. This is really, in some sense, a parable about medical research and developing a clinical understanding of complex disorders. So I'm using it as a metaphor, not necessarily as entirely focused on autism. So these are my disclosures. As my wife tells me, I don't get enough stock and other things, but that's the way it is. So lesson number one, what you see is not always what you get. The other night I gave a talk about autism, and I asked people to look at this picture and tell me which of these individuals had an autism spectrum disorder. And rather than belaboring the point, I had people raise their hands, and some people selected one individual, some selected another. Back up here. And usually this guy would get selected, and sometimes this guy would get selected, just because they look weird or different. But the point that I really want to make on this is you can't look at a still photo of anybody and decide whether they have an autism spectrum disorder. ASD is a disorder of transactions between human beings, and if you can't see and experience those transactions, you can't make a diagnosis. And that's just the plain and simple part of it. And that's true of many psychiatric disorders, in some sense makes them somewhat different than other medical conditions, because sometimes you can do medical tests or have the patients passively involved. Now, one of the problems that we have with thinking about disorders like this is that oftentimes people's knowledge of them largely comes from places other than the clinical environment. This happens to be a young man named Miko Hughes, who I worked with on a film with Bruce Willis in my youth. I wasn't as gray then. It's a Mercury Rising was the film. If you go and watch it to the very end, the last frame, I get a credit. I was actually on an airplane once sitting next to a very attractive woman telling her I was involved with the movie and trying to be very impressive. And we're coming in for landing and the credits are rolling. And I said, don't worry, my name is in the credits, I'll show you. And they cut off the film like two frames before. But the important thing of this is partly what people's impressions of disorder like ASD are reflected by the media, and whether it's Mercury Rising, What's He Eating, Gilbert Grape, Rain Man, any number of films that have portrayed individuals with ASD often are caricatures of it and don't represent the full phenotype or the full syndrome. But for me as a clinician, I have to tell you, training him to be in this role was extraordinary, because I basically had to deconstruct the behaviors and take them apart and teach him to suppress all the normal usual reciprocal social interactions, so that when he was on the set acting, he didn't use the same kind of visual regard, he didn't use the same kind of body posture that we typically use. He had to suppress gesture. How hard was that? Well, it took about 8 weeks of working with him full time every day, including one-on-ones, but also with other children with ASD. And every day before we started filming, he would come to the set, change into his costume for the day, and we would spend 2 hours suppressing all these normal reciprocal urges. So the kinds of things that are impaired in autism are very powerful, and they're not easily dismissed, easily disrupted. So it's really a sign of something rather substantial that these kinds of social reciprocity, factors in social reciprocity are interrupted. Now, another characterization of autism has largely been one of individuals who are quite intellectually impaired or severely disabled and unavailable to participate in the world. This is Temple Grandin. Many of you know of her. There's a wonderful HBO film about her, and I know Temple quite well, and I can tell you the portrayal of her is really very good. But Temple is enormously successful. I mean, she is the world's leading authority on how to slaughter cattle. And if you think that's trivial, first of all, slaughtering cattle is a big business, but it's so important. Her consulting business, which she runs, is considered the standard, and companies like McDonald's will not buy beef from somebody unless she approves their slaughtering procedures. You think she has a good living, and she does very well. She travels all over the world and is enormously successful. But I can tell you, when you spend time with her, or if you watch the film, she is quite severely impaired when it comes to reciprocal social interactions. Doesn't mean she can't function in the world, but it really has a different set of skills. So what is ASD, Autism Spectrum Disorder? Well, it's a group of what we think of as pediatric onset neuropsychiatric disorders, all of which have some evidence of a developmental neurobiological substrate or etiology. They almost all are heritable, and they would include autism or ASD, ADHD, OCD, Tourette's, and each of them shares some common characteristics in that they evolve over time, and they have complex behavioral and other events taking place during the course. And there's a suggestion of complex genetics in these disorders, with monozygotic twins being highly concordant relative to dizygotic twins. I'll come back to that in a moment. And people have thought recently about it being a spectrum or a group of conditions that share characteristics. In the current diagnostic criteria, there are five conditions: Rett syndrome, childhood disintegrative disorder, autistic disorder, Asperger's disorder, and PDD-NOS. These boundaries are quite blurred, and the phenotypes are not as sharply demarcated as we used to think they are, and the current diagnostic system is really abolishing a large part of it. But autism spectrum disorders are a syndrome that is not a disease state for which we have a known etiology. A syndrome is a collection of symptoms that tend to cluster together and share a common natural history. Tend to cluster together. Not everybody has all the symptoms. In fact, only about 1 in 500 has all the diagnostic criteria. Everybody else has a few. There are two fundamental elements of it: developmental delay and developmental deviation. That is, things don't occur on time. Also, things occur that wouldn't be expected in typical development. And there are three main areas of disrupted functioning: social development, communication, and a set of unusual, restricted, repetitive behaviors and interests. And these are common to all of them. The onset, by definition, is before the age of 30 months, but in fact, most people believe that autism or ASD begins probably in utero with some disruption in brain development. And it's not uncommon for individuals to start developing, and a significant percentage, perhaps a third to a half, have a regression of some sort. We'll come back and talk about how important that is in a moment. Motor and sensory function is preserved. There's no specific dysmorphic features. And for most individuals with ASD, there's no other associated medical conditions. As a result, they live normal lifespans and have the potential for long and relatively healthy lives. The course is consistent over time. That is, people tend to get better. Some of the symptoms tend to decrease, particularly the very stereotypic behaviors like hand flapping and rocking, which may be common. And the other symptoms, though, persist: the lack of social reciprocity, difficulty managing and using language, particularly in social settings, and these difficulties in understanding emotional concepts. Also, the restricted and repetitive behaviors can continue to some degree. Lesson number two. If you don't know where you've been, you don't know where you're going. we're in a time when information is piling up so fast that we forget how these syndromes came to be and what's important about them and the science that underlies what we're thinking about today. I mentioned the other night, but I'll show a picture today, that really there have been descriptions of autism in the literature, lay literature, going back thousands of years. But most of us begin think about it as beginning in the mid-1850s when Itard described a boy named Victor. This is Victor, that's Itard. A boy who the people in the community found in the city of Aveyron, France, thought he had been reared by wolves. So Itard, being the studious individual and a very wonderful, compassionate psychologist, went and picked up Victor, brought him to Paris, and tried to teach him social skills. And he documented this in a wonderful book called The Wild Boy of Aveyron, which has been translated into English. And in it, he describes how he taught Victor many skills. He was learned to dress and take care of himself, cleaning, toileting, etc. And he was able to go out to parties with Itard and learn how to use all the knives and forks and behave appropriately at dinners, even though he really never learned how to speak and participate in reciprocal social interactions. The real beginning of the history of autism is with Leo Kanner, who is a founder of child psychiatry in this country at Johns Hopkins. And in 1943, he wrote a paper in a journal called The Nervous Child called Autistic Disturbances of Affective Content. The term autism really came from way before Bleuler's notion of this social isolation. And in that paper, Kanner described 11 kids and described basically the course of their illness. And I'll come back to that in just a moment. At the same time, in Vienna, Hans Asperger wrote a thesis describing four boys who had what he called autistic psychopathy. Was it coincidence that Asperger and Kanner wrote and used the same term, autistic and autism? Probably not. I suspect Kanner, who read German very well, knew about what Asperger's work was doing and vice versa, and somehow they probably were in communication, although both denied it later. Each said they came up with the term independently. But Asperger's kids were basically much higher functioning than the individuals that Kanner described, and as I'll show you in a moment. And then, this is for Uli and me. This is a picture of Danny Friedman, who was my chairman when I started. But Danny was really quite pivotal in early studies of autism because he, in 1959, reported the first stable biological finding in autism, which was hyperserotonemia in about 40% of individuals with autism. Now, hyperserotonemia was important. If you ask Danny why did he think to look at hyperserotonemia and autism, it was one really simple reason. He could measure it. And he could identify a population, and it was measurable. Was there any particular theoretical reason behind it? No. And by the way, now, 1959, 50 years ago, we still actually don't know why children with autism have very high levels of serotonin. But I'm going to come back to that in a moment as well. But he was really the beginning of the biological age of studying developmental disorders, including autism. In the absence of empirical data, any theory will do, at least for some folks. So while there was a great interest in trying to generate an empirical substrate for understanding the disorders, there were a number of people who clearly weren't so interested. I put Leo Kanner on this list partly because he described these kids, but at the same time he described their families as being rather different than the general population. He talked about the parents as being somewhat distant, being very intellectual. The moms worked, which in the 1930s was atypical, and so they weren't there to rear their children. The dads were often absent, going away on trips or busy with their own work, and the children didn't get the same intensity of rearing, and there was a disproportionate number of different of racial and ethnic groups. And so Kanner arrived at this conclusion that these environmental factors played a substantial role in the causality of autism. What Kanner didn't tell us and didn't realize until many years later was that his description of the population of parents really reflected his practice, which was largely Johns Hopkins faculty and people from the community around there, rather than anything uniquely related to autism. A message that we need to remember today as we look at samples and try to ascertain the phenotype of disorder. We certainly are all familiar with Brunel Bettelheim and his work that generated the term refrigerator mother. He insisted that the moms were destroying their children. In fact, he refused to speak to mothers, and his treatment was to take the children away from the moms and reparent them, as only he could do. Now, there are two things I want to tell you about Bettelheim. Number one, despite his idiosyncratic approach to the world, he wrote beautiful picture stories about children with autism and their treatment. So his book, The Empty Fortress, is an extraordinarily beautiful description of a child with autism and became very important in making it publicly approachable in the 1950s. The second thing is Bettelheim started a school where he tried to treat children. The interesting irony is I ran that school for 3 years and I reviewed the records of the kids that he called autistic and virtually none of them were. But that's nonetheless a piece of history. He, at least from a literary point of view, he was important, theoretically wrong. And then the last person I want to mention is Margaret Mahler, who was a psychoanalyst who was sure that autism was caused by developmental disruption. And she did studies proving that there was so-called normal autistic phase of development. And it was a job of mothers to pull their children out of that normal autistic phase of development. Of course, and she did careful observations, which were completely flawed. And there is no such thing as a normal autistic phase of development. And recent, by that I mean the last 40 years, of studies of children show that social reciprocity is present at birth. It is a fundamental part of the engagement of the child, and it's a bilateral event. It's not just moms. Babies engage their mothers, mothers engage their babies, and I know this may be a shock, but babies are relatively undifferentiated in their engagement. They even will engage their fathers. And because it's so important for survival to have these social interactions. So these notions about what this disorder was were completely wrong, even though some of the people may have been well-intended. Mothers know best. This is something we should always remember. In the 1950s, 60s, and 70s, the whole study of autism was completely stagnated by a group of clinicians who were sure they knew what was right. And finally, in the 1970s, there was an organization called the National Society for Autistic Children, later changed to Autistic Citizens, and now the Autism Society of America. And these moms got together, and it was moms. And they said, this is ridiculous. You people don't know what you're talking about. We're not causing our kids to be autistic. And we need to now have science. And so the first thing they did is assembled a group of individuals and said, come up with diagnostic criteria or descriptive criteria so you can study this at multiple sites. If you're not using the same definition, then you're not studying the same thing. This was moms who did this. It wasn't scientists. It wasn't the academics who really should have taken the initiative. And then they funded research in the 1970s that really changed the way we looked at the disorder. They made different centers look at it from a point of view of phenomenology, but also for treatment and etiology. Now, as this was taking place in 1970s, Connor went back and looked at his kids 28 years later, and he said, this is what I found. And the first thing he did was apologize. He said, I mischaracterized the population. He did this publicly and said, this is not a disorder caused by mothering. This is a disorder that's a neurobiological disorder and something disruptive in the brain. The second thing he did for us was gave us a follow-up of the 11 kids. And the thing that's most noteworthy is, of the 11, only one lived semi-independently. The rest ended up in some kind of residential protected environment. Some were quite severely handicapped. One died early related to seizure disorders, which probably wouldn't happen today. But the point is, these were kids who now became quite severely impaired in adulthood, characterizing what up until recently has been the basic reflection of the epidemiology of this disorder. That is, about 90 or 95% of the individuals are severely impaired and have to be in custodial care, and occasionally one will have independent or semi-independent functioning. Lesson five, you have to know what you're looking for in order to look for it. This may seem obvious, but it's absolutely true. We often go to search for something and don't agree on what the phenotype or what the descriptions are. So DSM-4 and following on DSM-3, which was built, really, DSM-4 was built on the NSAC criteria, decided that there were 5 syndromes, and developed a set of diagnostic criteria, which are fundamentally the same as the NSAC criteria. And by having those criteria, and then developing instruments to assess them, we were really able to change the way we approach the disorder. Without having specific diagnostic criteria, you really can't work across centers, but you also can't measure the phenotype with any kind of precision. And when one went to look across these various conditions, syndromes, sub-syndromes, if you will, one found that there were 2 things that were common to all of them. One is all of them had difficulties with reciprocal social behavior, and all of them had restricted repetitive behaviors and interests. And this kept recurring as part of the phenotype of the disorder. And cognitive ability and language functioning seemed to not make much difference. It only in terms of how these behaviors express themselves, but not in any way marking the condition. And this is an important step, because it's led to now what we're thinking about in terms of DSM-5 and autism spectrum disorder, which is really a disorder that has 2 fundamental elements: deficits in social communication and interaction, and restricted repetitive patterns of behaviors and interests and activities. So over time, as we've come to study the disorder, one of the things that sort of disappeared, or not exactly disappeared, but faded into the background. And that's the intellectual disability, this notion that these individuals are all profoundly intellectually impaired, along with the problems of social deficits. And as it turns out, when you look in very intellectually disabled populations, they have a lot of social deficits, but the social deficits are qualitatively different. And many people with intellectual deficits also have very excellent social skills. They just don't have good language and adaptive skills. So this is the way we're currently thinking about the disorder, which now leads us to a different way of phenotyping the condition. Even if you don't see what you're looking for, it may still be there. So currently, there's this great controversy about how many people have autism spectrum disorder. How can they possibly all have been there? Adults say this all the time, kids know better. How could it possibly have been there and I never saw it? I went to school, I didn't have all these kids with autism. Where did they come from? Well, it must be that they came anew because I didn't see them. Is that really true? Let me give you an example. Here's something that's very familiar to you. You see it all the time. Every day, the trucks drive by you, you get it in the mail, and you know this very well. I'm about to change your way of looking at it, because you may not have noticed that there's an arrow in the middle of FedEx. It's been there every day. Every time you've seen it, it's been there, and you never noticed it before now. And by the way, from this point forward, you will never look at a FedEx truck without seeing that arrow. Okay? So just because you don't see it, you haven't seen the arrow is in yellow up here. Okay. Someone was pointing. So just because you don't see it doesn't mean it wasn't there. And just because you didn't see autism or ASD doesn't mean it hasn't been there all along. Well, where has it been? Well, if one looks at recent, over the past 40 years, epidemiologic studies of sorts, estimates of prevalence have been rising significantly. But why has this been happening? This is really very important. Largely, it comes from several factors. This is one of the studies that has been used most to say that there's an epidemic of autism. You'll see, beginning in around 1975, all of a sudden, the number of cases rose dramatically. And by the way, this curve continues into 2000. What happened in 1972, 73, 74, 75? Did we all of a sudden have ASD toxins? What happened? Let me suggest to you 2 things happened. Number one, Public Law 94-142, the Education for All Handicapped Children's Act, which forced schools to identify children who had disabilities and said that they had to treat them in their schools. They had to provide them an education. The second thing was the NSAC criteria, diagnostic criteria. We could now define the disorder. Did anything change in terms of the population? Probably not. Probably not at all. So this is the problem of looking at, by the way, service data. These data come from the California Department of Education. They had to serve more kids starting then. This is from the state of Minnesota. Are they a little behind California? Yes, they are. But one of the things that's different, in 1991-92, the school year, the state of Minnesota put in its school rules a definition of autism. So children now could be defined as needing special services for autism rather than in some other category. And this is a set of data from California, again, looking at how that may have affected the system. This is mental retardation. This is autism. So the number of cases of autism are rising, and the number of cases of mental retardation are declining. This is how they're classified by for service. Mental retardation, or now intellectual disability, by definition is 3% of the population. It can't change. It's arbitrarily defined. So why is it changing? It's classification in a service system. It's not that the number of people have changed. So when we look at this from a slightly different perspective, we can see that if you take the same population and study them, if you apply different diagnostic criteria, you get a different prevalence. So Connor criteria, DSM-4 criteria, ICD-10 criteria, just changing criteria changes prevalence. So which criteria you use to define the disorder made a difference. And this is just another example of that. And one of the things you can see is that the difference can change as much as fivefold by just changing criteria. And this is a set of studies that are from the same area, from England, which is a relatively small place. And by using different diagnostic criteria and methods for surveying, starting with administrative records up to a very intensive screening, the prevalence changes almost 15-fold. So without changing the population, changing the people, but changing the methods by which you go and find them, you change the number of people that are there. They're finding their arrows. Lesson 7, a job worth doing is worth doing well. Even if they tell you it can't be done, they don't want to pay for it, and they don't like the answers when you are done. So I'm going to tell you just briefly about our Korean epidemiologic study. But let me remind you that we have to use the right term. Prevalence is the number of cases at any particular time. Incidence is the number of new cases at a particular time. We're talking about prevalence. We're not talking about incidence right now. Whoop, back up. So this is a study we did in Korea. The target population was with my wife, Young Shin, who really is the brains of the operation. We looked at a target population of 55,000 children, an entire community sample, and attempted to screen the entire community. In that population, we found that 2.64% of the children with ASD had ASD. And that was divided into two groups, a general population sample, kids who had never been identified, never received any services, and then a group of kids who had been identified by disability registry or received special education or other medical psychiatric services. And so you can see that the vast majority of the kids who we identified had never been identified before. They were the arrows. These are the FedExes. Were they not there? Well, when we asked the teachers, Johnny here, or whatever their Korean name might be, I have a Korean name, so it could be Soo Young. Was little Soo Young a problem? Of course he was a problem. The teacher would say, well, why didn't you call him autism? Well, I didn't know what to call him. I didn't know what it was, but I knew it was there. He just didn't get counted. And you can see that in the distribution that having any autistic disorder versus autism, the classical autism, most kids had the broader spectrum. But still at 0.94%, that's more than the general population reports had been previously for the most part. Now, one of the things that's really important about this study, actually perhaps more dramatic than the number itself, is that the two populations of individuals were different. So people that we called in the high probability group, the kids who had previously arranged services, about 3/4 of them had classical autism, and they're on the SRS, the social responsiveness scale, their difficulties with social responsivity, they were quite severely impaired. The sex ratio was 5-1 males to females. The mean performance IQ was 75. And their adaptability scores were quite low. When you looked at the kids who had not been previously identified, there are a couple things that are really striking. One is their social responsivity is better, but still impaired. Their sex ratio is 2.5-1. Many more females fall into this category, and their cognitive level is in the average range. So these are, you could say, are they different? No. They're part of a continuum that represents the phenotypic expression of this disorder. So their variability in social responsiveness, cognitive levels, et cetera. So why has the prevalence of ASD increased? Is there an epidemic? I don't think so. I think our data and other data would suggest that there are more. The reason we think there are more is because there's increased demand for services, the diagnostic criteria have changed, the methods for doing the studies are improving, and a number of other reasons, diagnostic switching, et cetera. But do we know whether there's an actual increase in incidence? The answer is we don't, because a proper incidence study has never been done. Our guess is that if it is the case, it accounts for a small amount of the increase, that the vast majority of individuals were already there. We're actually doing the incident study now, so invite us back in a few years and we'll tell you what the truth is. Lesson 8, diagnostic specificity and sensitivity are necessary but not sufficient. You really have to look at the phenotype dimensionally across the entire spectrum of behaviors. And until we can look at dimensional phenotypes rather than categorical systems, we're going to have a tough time. What do we mean by dimensional phenotypes? Well, I'm going to talk about a few of those in just a second. This is just to show you how specific and sensitive we are in making the diagnosis. This is a work by Kathy Lord in which I participated a number of years ago. We looked at 108 kids at the age of 2 and made diagnoses on them. And then they were followed up 5 years later. All these 108 met diagnostic criteria for narrowly defined autism. 3 years later, 61% of them still met diagnostic criteria for autism. You say, well, that's not so great. But then if you add in another 25% that had at least some form of an autism spectrum disorder, we're now 86%. At the age of 2, we were able to make that diagnosis, and it holds for 86%. And of the 14% that were not ASD, all of them had developmental disabilities. So the diagnostic systems that we use, the way we classify, are actually pretty damn good. And this group was then followed up, and at the age of 9, 84% of them still had a diagnosis of an autism spectrum disorder, of autism, and 15% were autism spectrum disorder, and 1% did not. So as they get older and the disorder expresses itself more clearly, the diagnosis really gets reaffirmed. So the point is, over time, this is a relatively stable set of characteristics and behavior. This group has now been followed to the age of 15, and it's very similar. So what are the measures of dimensional phenotypes that are relative to autism, and can we measure them? The answer is yes. First of all, there's the issue of social responsiveness. Can people participate in reciprocal social behaviors? And is this a continuum from relatively normative functioning into relatively impaired functioning? So it allows us to look at the substrates of a continuous characteristic in the individuals. The same has to do with repetitive behaviors, compulsivity, and then two really important concepts, theory of mind and joint attention. And are these measurable continuously? Theory of mind is the ability to think about what someone else is thinking and use that to adapt your behavior. And joint attention is the ability to join others in what they're thinking and help them join you in what you're thinking or attending to. So that it's all part of this reciprocal social functioning, the critical nuances that form the substrate of this disorder. This is work from Ami Klin, who showed one of the elements of social functioning related to autism. What he did is he showed people with autism the film, this happens to be Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, which is a very intense set of social interactions. And when you show this to people who are typical, their visualizations, this is eye tracking, look at the faces and the eyes of the characters who are interacting with one another. The individuals with autism spectrum disorder occasionally look at the face, but the rest of the time are kind of drifting around at other things in the environment. So their ability to appreciate social cues is quite limited. If you don't see them, you can't appreciate them, and how do you react to them or respond to them? Now, this is clever enough, I mean, but what about adults who are, you know, or older individuals who are engaged in social interactions? Well, Ami went back and did the same thing with children and had children with each other and did eye tracking with them. And one of the things that he found is that typically developing children look at each other's eyes and faces even when they're infants and toddlers, whereas the children with autism tend to focus on objects and parts of the face and not continue to focus on the face. So this is something that begins early in life, very early, and is persistent throughout the lifespan for individuals with autism spectrum disorders. So we can look at these phenotypes and they can become meaningful. When you know what you're looking for, it's hard to figure out what it is. So sometimes we have a general idea of a notion, but getting specific is really crucial, particularly if we're interested in etiology and biological substrates of disorder. In the case of autism, we have a bunch of serious problems. There are no animal models because the nuances of social interaction in animals are very different than they are in humans. And because the patients themselves don't have increased mortality, they're protected, so they rarely have accidents. And they have normal lifespans, so when they die, their brains are got Alzheimer's disease and strokes and all the things that are going to interfere with us figuring out what their brain function is. And then it's very difficult sometimes to get them to cooperate with certain kinds of procedures, like putting them in a scanner. It's difficult to get typical people to do that, let alone getting someone with autism who might not understand. And then, of course, there are the ethical problems of consent. Do they understand? And so as a result, many of the studies that look at biological markers are largely very high-functioning individuals. And remember I said what's important is to be able to look at the whole range of phenotypes. But the studies that we're seeing, like MRI scanning and other things, may really be restricted to one end of the spectrum rather than the continuity. And it's important for us to understand that. The other thing we have to remember that autism not only affects development, but it is affected by development. The kind of experiences a person has, not just in their social life, but also their physical development, etc., has an impact on the phenotypic expression in the disorder. And so we're stuck trying to figure out, is this experience or is this the biology, and what extent each applies. And the other problem is that there are a large number of syndromes that have components. They syndromally share elements of autism spectrum disorder. And some of these are genetic syndromes. Some of them we don't know the etiology at all. But it's clear that autism isn't just narrowly restricted to one group of individuals who have no other problems. But to what extent they overlap is still a bit of a mystery. Lesson number 10. You're probably wondering at this point how many lessons there are, but I'm not going to tell you. Even if you know what you're looking for, finding it is not always easy. We know that we have a pretty good sense that what's happening is some kind of developmental disruption in the brain. Why do we know that? Well, there's certain evidence that people have looked at, starting with Danny Friedman and his work, in the looking at the things they can measure, neurochemistry and basic neural functioning. And there's certainly been evidence that there are abnormalities in the norepinephrine system, although some say that it's overactivated, some underactivated, but nonetheless there's evidence in noradrenergic systems, in dopaminergic systems, with serotonin. I've already mentioned the hyperserotonemia, which is really interesting because hyperserotonemia is largely related to how much serotonin is in platelets, and what does that mean about membrane transfer of serotonin, and is this an indicator of some membrane functional anomaly? I'll mention something about that a little bit later. And what does it mean to have these kind of neurochemical abnormalities? There have also been studies looking at cellular functioning and finding abnormalities in lymphocyte function, T and B cells, etc. But a small proportion, 10%, 5%, 20%, not consistently across the spectrum of individuals examined with ASD. So that leads to lesson 11. Sometimes when you have no place to turn, you turn in the right direction. This is a study that I did with Dan at the University of Chicago many years ago. What we did is we plotted to children's whole blood serotonin levels against their mother's serotonin levels to see if they correlated. And you know, for a biological event, it was a pretty high correlation and highly statistically significant. That was a good idea. So we said, what the hell, let's go look and see at the kids against their fathers. And once again, we got a pretty high correlation. So then, being really smart Alex, we did this, and we plotted mothers against fathers. And the correlation was equally high. Well, this led us to one of two inevitable conclusions. One is that people who have autism mate on the basis of their serotonin levels. Not a very probable event. Possible, but not probable. Or that the genetic factors that control autism, I mean serotonin levels, play a role in the creation of autism. And so people who have a predilection for higher serotonin levels are more likely when they mate to have children with higher serotonin levels, and that may increase the risk for autism. And at this point, Dan and me and my colleague Ed Cook completely switched directions. We put aside neurochemistry and started looking at genetics. And so, and this was a long time ago, when one did genetics one base pair at a time, it was really slow. But in fact, I remember when we got our first sequencer, a single channel ABI, that took more time than I care to remember to sequence. It was a tedious time. But nonetheless, over the past several years, it's become quite clear that ASD is a highly genetic, and perhaps amongst the most genetic of all psychiatric disorders. The family recurrence rate is unusual. At 5%, it's still 100 times more likely than the occurrence in the general population. Maybe it's twice or three times, but it's much more likely in the general population. But there's some concern, because in monozygotic twins, only 60% are concordant. That's where the story would end if we didn't stop and think about phenotyping. If one looks at the continuous phenotype, one finds that really, amongst monozygotic twins, 90% really fit on the autism spectrum. So while the entire syndrome may not be transmitted in monozygotic twins, at least it plays a very major role. Heritability is quite high. But it probably doesn't account for everything. And what role environment plays is still a critical question for us. It's been reported that there are sex ratio differences. We've talked a little bit about that. One of the other things I just want to mention is that one of the difficulties we have in autism research is we don't have pedigrees because they're stoppage. People with autism don't have children very frequently, and as a result, we don't end up with extended pedigrees. But there's certainly some evidence to suggest that autism is a complex genetic disorder with multiple interacting loci. Some people have estimated between 20 and 100, who knows, but it certainly looks like it's a complex genetic disorder, not unlike most common medical conditions today. Now, chromosomal abnormalities have been reported on almost every chromosome, especially on 715 and the X chromosome, and there have been multiple genome-wide linkage studies with 2Q, 7Q, 17Q, and more coming all the time. And there have been association studies with a whole variety of transporters, including the serotonin, a whole variety of genes, including serotonin transporter, reelin, contactin, oxytocin, et cetera. And basically every gene has some marks on it. And the problem is sorting out which one of these has any kind of meaning. So if one goes back and looks at the number of studies that have taken place over the past 10 years, one finds that, first of all, the numbers of genetic studies are rising enormously, and the number of cases involved is rising, but is still remarkably small. I mean, we're looking at studies of 17, 18, 20, 30, 40, up to a few hundred subjects, numbers that are really pitifully small to do any kind of genetic assessment that we want. So these are case control studies, and these are family-based studies, and the number of alleles reported is relatively large given the number of samples that we're looking at. And it's across countries, but the story is sort of vague and not particularly clear. And when one takes this and does a meta-analysis, one finds that overall the association for any of the genes in question is really very weak, if any at all. So thus far, all the single candidate gene studies have not really held up. And the reason they don't hold up is as you get more subjects and you do more studies, the odds ratios drop and disappear. And we say, oh, woe is me. This is a problem for autism research. This is because we have a lousy phenotype. This is because we do poor research because we don't study the right patients in the right way. Well, I'd just like to point out for the rest of medicine, it's exactly the same problem. This is the so-called winner's curse. The first person reports a finding at a very high odds ratio, and over time, as more and more subjects are added to the pool, whether it's nephropathy, alcoholism, hypertension, Parkinson's, lung cancer, schizophrenia, doesn't matter, over time, the odds ratios decline to basically zero. So these association studies are really not proving anything very useful in any medical condition. So it's not just unique to autism. Lesson 11, maps, including genetic maps, are good, but they don't necessarily show you the right way to go. And so as we know from having all this genetic data, really, what have we ended up with? Well, we don't know much about the interactions between genes, and we know even less about the interactions between genes and environment. What do we study? What environmental toxins or factors are significant in looking at disorder? There are actually some indications of some things that may be, and then who do we study? How do we know who's been exposed to what, when, and where? And how much have they been exposed to? One of the best models to look at is the evolving story of cigarette smoke, nicotine exposure in utero. It surely looks like it's a profoundly powerful teratogen, but its damage seems to be relatively nonspecific. We see increased risk for a whole variety of conditions, ranging from ADHD and autism to asthma. So what is it about a teratogen that, or some other toxic exposure that allows us to figure out its interactions that leads to a specific condition? We don't know yet. And we haven't really looked at populations in a way that are really appropriate. We're not measuring continuous phenotypes, and we're not looking at representative samples. And for some things like nicotine, we don't actually have studies that have properly assessed the dosage, timing and dosage of exposure. Using self-reports isn't useful. Cotinine levels have to be measured repeatedly. Hair samples don't mean a damn thing. And so finding the way to measure exposure, the timing exposure, and dose of exposure, as well as the population in which the exposure takes place, is proving to be a vexing problem, not just for autism research, but also for other conditions. As it turns out, we're probably going to end up having to begin with things that we can measure relatively stably, like birth weight or prematurity, perinatal complications, where reports are not entirely dependent on retrospective recall. So, as I suggested before, there's not 100% concordance rate, so that environmental factors largely play a role. There's certainly some evidence of toxins, rubella, valproate, and thalidomide have certainly been shown to increase the likelihood of having an autism spectrum disorder. But as it turns out now, we have to really think really hard about the environmental factors that we can measure and how we're going to assess them, ranging from perinatal complications to heavy metal exposure, vaccines, pesticides, geography, and so on. This is something that's just beginning to take hold. And so we're really left to speculate about what environmental factors interact with genes to cause autism. For sure they do, but the time has not come for us to figure that out. I'm going to skip that. Lesson 12. A picture is worth 1,000 words, but even pretty pictures cannot tell the whole story. Most recently, there's been a great deal of interest in our ability to image the brain. And since the brain is the cause of autism, we think, or something developing in the brain, there's certainly evidence that brains of people with autism may be somewhat different. About 20 to 50% of individuals with autism have increased head circumferences, and among those, many normalized by the age of 24 months, but it persists in about 20%. And there's some speculation about why this occurs. But these symptoms, this association has only really directly been associated with intellectual disability. However, many individuals with autism who have no intellectual disability have this anatomic finding. So it occurs when you look at a larger sample of children with autism, macrocephaly occurs in 3% of the general population, 20% of individuals with autism, and it's probably related to some level of either overgrowth or failure in pruning. There's also, and the converse is, this, a series of studies that have looked at the cerebellum and found the hypoplastic cerebella in 15 to 25% of individuals with autism. So while the cortex may be bigger, the cerebella is smaller. But by the way, it doesn't necessarily occur together, and there's no phenotypic variation that's accountable for by these differences in head sizes or anatomic differences. Now, there's also been looking at particular areas in the brain which seem to be responsible for activities related to the social deficits in autism. So there's some evidence of decreased size of hippocampus, where memory and learning takes place, a decreased amygdalae, and where gaze, emotional recognition take place, and decreased in the number of Purkinje cells in the cerebellum, where attentional functioning takes place. But again, not a consistent finding, but nonetheless, indication that there may be some possible biological markers for disorder. In the few autopsy studies that exist, there's some evidence of failures to migrate appropriately and develop lamination in the brain, again, small samples, and that dendrification is different, apparently far more extensive in individuals with autism. This has led to some speculation in a variety of areas. PET studies have been inconsistent, as have functional MRI studies. But the notion of having a large head size and high levels of dendrification in individuals who've been autopsied have led to the suggestion that there's a failure of pruning. As you know, we have excessive numbers of neurons, and then as experience takes place, we get rid of the ones we don't need and reinforce the connections that are more useful. And so the suggestion is that that pruning may be failing in the significant number of individuals with autism. Again, not something that's established. So there's been a whole variety of fMRI studies. I talked with one of your colleagues last night about this. One of the problems with the fMRI studies, though, is that the sample sizes are so small and the measures of these particular characteristics are so limited that being able to arrive at any significant conclusions that these are biomarkers really are beyond our reach at this point in time. And when you look at studies of 15 individuals and 8 controls, it's really impossible to figure this out, although the pictures look great. As soon as you admit that you don't know for sure, others will know for sure. Andrew Wakefield and his work first decided that abdominal gastrointestinal problems were associated with increased levels of autism. However, when people went and looked in real populations, he just did this on a sample from his GI clinic in London, that they found basically no cases of inflammatory bowel disease, which Wakefield said was common in the individuals with autism. And in other studies, they found that the amount of GI symptoms were no different than in the general population. And then, so then the suggestion was that it was associated with regression. And when they looked at the percent of people who had bowel symptoms who had regression, it was actually the ones with regression had less bowel symptoms than the ones who did have regression. So there was no association there. So then Wakefield published another paper in 1998 in which he said that vaccines were the cause of autism, and he had a sort of preposterous story about how the vaccine left viruses in the gut that went through the gut wall, and the gut wall was defective in the individual with autism and somehow wiggled up to the brain and caused autism. But nonetheless, this became a serious issue and has led to the question about whether there's an autism epidemic caused by MMR vaccine. These are a series of cartoons to show you that this is autism prevalence and this is the rate of vaccination, no relationship at all in California. This is another sample looking at uptake of vaccine and autism prevalence. Again, no relationship at all. And so then the suggestion was this only played a role in children who had regression. And so when you look at individuals who have autism and look for age of identification of the symptoms, most parents sort of figure it out around 20 months. And so if the vaccine is given at a year, one would expect then the age of identification to drop if it was actually causing the disorder. But when you look at kids, family study before MMR was available. The mean age of identification of the children was 19.5 months. Post-MMR, 19.2 months and 19.3 months in two separate studies. So the relationship between regression disappears. So then we get criticized because why don't we take this seriously? You know, as a scientist, I'd be thrilled if MMR caused autism. I'm thrilled, but it would be a clue of some kind of mechanism for the disorder that we could explore. But this clearly isn't the case. Come on. Go. All right, there you go. So then the question was it really not the MMR, but the vaccine's preservative? I'm sorry you can't see this, but mercury caused it. If you could see this, you would see that that mercury was taken out of the vaccines in the early 1990s, and the prevalence continues to rise. So the presence of mercury has nothing to do with this. And in fact, the whole mercury theory is scientifically flawed because the mercury that we actually put in vaccines is like mercurochrome, ethyl mercury, which is relatively rapidly excreted and not as highly neurotoxic as the industrial waste methyl mercury, which has been reported to be a teratogen and quite a lethal toxin. Now, and then this is a bit of data looking at all the studies of the relationship between MMR and autism. And what we found is that if anything, having MMR vaccine is protective, not increasing the risk. You know what? This is just like common sense and logical. This is a grandmother story in that, and I'm not being pejorative, I think grandmothers are wise. Why it took us so long to figure this out is a real mystery. Lesson 14. 1 year of work in the laboratory will save 3 hours of reading in the library almost every time. Had we gone back and done the reading early, we would have found that, first of all, Wakefield wrote a paper in 1995 making exactly the same theory but about inflammatory bowel disease. And it turned out not to be true and was refuted. He did exactly the same thing. And that was the case. And if we look carefully at Wakefield's studies, one found that his methods were flawed. And in addition, he had conflicts of interest, including a patent for a measles vaccine that had no mercury in it, so that he had financial interest in the success of his outcome. So he was a fraud. But nonetheless, empirical sciences is useful only when properly applied by scientists or policymakers and the lay public. In other words, we have met the enemy and he is us. And why is the enemy us? Well, because we made terrible mistakes in this process. The world of medicine didn't stand up and scream that this was a travesty. We missed the details and what happened. Well, uptake rates of measles vaccine declined. Herd immunity was lost in a number of countries, including England. Herd immunity really is about 90 to 95%. You can see the immunity levels decline in England. And as a result, children started getting measles at higher rates, including dying and getting brain injury from measles. Measles is a common disorder. We just don't remember that in the United States because we rarely see it because we're all vaccinated. But around the world, kids get measles and die. And if we're not properly vaccinated and don't have herd immunity, if one of those kids happens to come to this country with measles, they can kill our children as well. So we didn't really respond to this very effectively. Well, what took so long? In 2004, 10 of the 14 co-authors of the paper withdrew their participation in the paper. It still took The Lancet another 6 years to retract the paper. And this came only after Wakefield was disciplined by the medical council in England and had his license revoked and found guilty of fraud. 1998 to 2010, 12 years of mischievous behavior, but also misdirecting us and resources along an avenue of research that was really not useful at all. Lesson 5, in spite of all the marvels of technology, the careful clinical examination of the patient is still necessary. Sorry, I wish we could do an MRI or a blood test for autism, or most other medical conditions we can't. We still have to examine patients and arrive at diagnoses. Diagnoses are important for sharing information, but they're also important for our patients in helping them understand the conditions they have and the community to which they belong. We still have to arrive at a diagnosis, and we have to understand the relevance of possible etiologies, prognosis, and treatment. That's our obligation to patients while we struggle to figure out what's going on with autism. There are a series of common deficits in autism. Of course, we want to know the assets as well, but we need to measure each of these carefully as part of the clinical process. We have to consider what our sources of information are. We have to talk to people. There are also structured evaluations, and the ADI and ADOS are the standard in the field internationally. They get used all over the world, and they really are quite reliable, highly sensitive, and specific for making the diagnosis. There are other structured instruments that can be useful as well, but applying structured instruments is really the standard of care today. We also have to assess cognitive functioning and verbal skills. And adaptive functioning, language, and I want to emphasize it's the assessment of language, not just speech. That is the full spectrum of communicative behaviors, gesture, facial expression, body posture, etc. There are many ways to assess this. And then we often forget, just because they have a behavioral problem, to do a full physical examination. We talked yesterday in one of our case conferences about children who have hearing deficits and visual deficits and who aren't properly assessed and are misclassified because these aren't taken into account. For the most part, laboratory studies are not terribly useful in making the diagnosis unless there are specific findings that lead us to that way. So a routine MRI and EEG is expensive, may be disruptive, and may not be particularly helpful unless there's a real clinical reason for doing it. Even if you don't know what you're doing, you may have to do something, so do it as well as possible. Unfortunately, we don't know the cause of autism, and we don't know how to treat it as specifically as a syndrome. But we still have patients we have to care for, and that doesn't mean we shouldn't exercise good judgment in the process. When one looks at studies about what affects outcome, there are clear data that show that language plays a really critical role in predicting outcome. Intellectual capacity also is highly predictive of outcome, as are adaptive functioning and severity of symptoms. There's probably not a lot we can do about intellectual capacity, but it seems to me these would point us in the directions of the kind of interventions we should consider. And even in young children, language and paying attention to social interactions seems to be highly predictive of better outcome. Are these things that we can shape and change? Yes, and there are evidence-based treatments to do that. So, I'm going to skip this, sorry. None of the treatments we have are targeted at a specific etiology. That's okay. That's true of many medical conditions. It's just fine. We don't have to feel ashamed about that. And none of the treatments are syndromally specific, but they are targeting specific signs and symptoms. And we really need to think about which symptoms and signs are the most crucial and design interventions to affect those most dramatically. And since the best predictor of outcome is language functioning, it would seem to me that the first step in any treatment is having an effective language program. And there are wonderful evidence-based language programs that are available that help increase gesture, vocalization, and then reciprocal social communication. There are lots of techniques that we can use, including computer-based, picture exchange programs, signing, all kinds of strategies to improve language functioning. We can also improve educational activities so the children can learn more and have more experiences. And taking advantage of the current laws is really crucial in that regard. There are also strategies for teaching social skills, highly structured curricula that allow us to teach children and adolescents and adults how to improve their social functioning. Again, if it's a predictor of outcome, it should be drawn to that straightforwardly. And behavioral therapy to decrease the intensity and severity of the disruptive symptoms, the symptoms that interfere with functioning and participation in the environment. Lesson 17, mother knows best again. So do grandparents and the other family members. We tend to forget that families are a crucial part of the treatment process. We can't do it without them, and parent training is a significant part of the entire process of treating if we're going to really make the best out of language, social skills training, etc. What about psychopharmacology? Well, that's the one that probably gets the most play, but unfortunately has there are a lot of hopes, but there's no magic here at all. And in fact, most of the time we're left to treating specific behaviors, and we have to remember that psychopharmacology is largely adjunctive and designed to support the other treatments that we use. And there have been many hopeful strategies for treating autism, but none of them have really proven to be definitive. The one I want to just remind you of is a story. We were participating in a drug called fenfluramine, which is a drug that lowers serotonin levels. So Dan and some people at UCLA had this brilliant idea. If we could lower serotonin levels in people hyperserotonemic, they would get better, because after all, hyperserotonemia was associated with autism. So it was actually, fenfluramine is a weight reduction drug. And so we put the kids, you can tell, it was a blind study, but you can tell when they went on the drug. We didn't actually show the investigators what the weights were. And by golly, when you lowered when you gave them the drug, their serotonin levels really dropped, about 50%. So, you know, we'd really expect to see something wild and important, huh? The original paper was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, and the group from Los Angeles, UCLA, reported a significant increase in cognitive level in this group of children that they studied. Went from, it looks really big, like it's a really big difference, right? Well, the difference between 43 and 46 is within the error of the test itself. And particularly at low levels of cognitive functioning, is probably not a very good measure. And unfortunately, this is now many years ago, we didn't measure other characteristics like social responsiveness and so on. But this is a potentially toxic drug that was designed to work on an etiological substrate for the disorder, really didn't work. And none of the other agents we've used have proven that successful based on etiology. However, there's some evidence that we can decrease stereotypies and restricted and repetitive behaviors, insistence on sameness with SSRIs. There are placebo-controlled trials in this area. There are also studies looking at aggression and irritability using both traditional, atypical neuroleptics and other agents that have been repeatedly shown to decrease aggression and irritability irrespective of the diagnosis, but has been done in children with autism. Attention problems, the use of stimulants and similar compounds that work for ADHD also work in autism for those children who have symptoms consistent with ADHD. And in addition, mood disorders and disruptions of mood also have been amenable to those kinds of interventions. Anxiety disorders are much more difficult to treat. Lesson 17. When no specific can be shown to cure a syndrome, someone will assert that there is one that does, even in the presence of data that it doesn't. And there are dozens of people who are selling and telling us that a whole variety of interventions work, ranging from vitamins and dietary supplements to hormones and who knows what else. There is no treatment that is specific for autism spectrum disorders. Lesson 18. It's important to keep an open mind, but not so open that your brain falls out. There are some treatment programs that look like they have specific utility. The TEACH program, which integrates parents and teachers and a whole variety of services into an integrated package, looks like it makes a difference. Behavior therapy and LOVAS model of ABA looks like it makes a difference, although probably not the way LOVAS described it. In studies of ABA, it looks like specific kinds of behaviors are amenable to treatment, others are not. This is Temple Grandin's squeeze machine. She swears by it and makes her feel better. There are no studies yet, but I think we should keep an open mind about it. Floor Time, Stanley Greenspan's program of following children around and letting them show you how they can get better, probably doesn't have a lot of merit, and there's no empirical trials of it at all. And then there are people who put things out. This is actually from Paula Talalan, looking at teaching kids to improve their language. But as you can see, in 6 weeks you can become in 1 day you can become a fast forward therapist. It's only $350 a person, paid in advance, $450 at the door. But you can become a therapist and you can change the lives of children. Sign up early. It includes lunch, by the way. There are other treatments that have been suggested. Again, none of them have worked particularly well, and some of them have been detrimental, facilitated communication being the most well-known of those, where kids were accusing their parents of all sorts of horrible things. Lesson 19. For individuals who know it is not their fault, stigma, humiliation, and discrimination cause indescribable pain. Bullying and stigma about kids who have autism and their families is a horrible situation and exists today despite our enlightened spirit. And we need to be sensitive to that. It's a critical part of that interferes with treatment, but it also interferes with our research. Bias is really a problem. Lesson 20, it's hard to be patient when you don't want to be patient. If you're a parent of a child with autism, you don't want to sit around and wait for guys like me to find a treatment or to find the cause. And people are desperate, they're vulnerable, and they really need sound guidance, advice, and support. But it's unfortunately, the answers are not likely to come soon. And so helping them adapt in the current climate is really important. But waiting for empirically tested treatment and understanding is really crucial. I'm almost done. Lesson 21, despite the complexities and frustrations, the future is actually bright in this area. We actually now have solid models for research. We understand that we have to have sufficient population size samples and appropriately controlled studies. We need to include the full spectrum and measure the phenotypes along those spectrums. We know how to do that. And we have the capacity for doing this kind of phenotyping and consistently identifying cases over the course of disorder. And of course, there are new markers, biomarkers available for us. And there are even models starting to evolve for the kind of protein and neural substrates of disorder. This is a substrate for the oxytocin system, which has been suggested to play a role in the development of social functioning, at least in animals and some evidence in humans. And there are models that are beginning to develop of how we can think about parts of the brain, genetics, and neurochemistry to pull together this disorder. Lesson 22. Even when you don't, when you think you don't know much, you probably know more than you think. At this point, we know actually a lot about phenotyping this disorder. It's changed dramatically in the past few years. We can do it behaviorally, psychologically, and biologically. We just haven't been applying it thoughtfully and consistently across well-selected samples and populations. But we do know that autism is a heterogeneous disorder that probably involves genes active in early brain development, that it is etiologically heterogeneous. There are rare mutations of major effect causing some of the disorders, multiple genes acting in concert causing others, gene-gene interactions, and gene-environment interactions. And how these interact with one another and how they shape different phenotypic expression is really something we have to work on. But there's evidence for each of these models. Phenotypic characterization will be crucial in the future, and you're going to have to be patient as we start to identify these phenotypes and how to measure them. But continuous dimensional phenotypes are going to be crucial rather than categorical phenotyping. That is diagnosis. But we need diagnosis to get insurance paid for to get kids in school, so we have to do both. And that's the challenge for us in the work that we do. And most children, we have to remember, with autism spectrum disorders get better. Our goals at the current time, from a scientific point of view, are to enhance treatment and prevent ASD. But we, in the meantime, we have to think about treatments that at least reduce the symptoms and allow them to grow and develop the skills that they need to function as well as they can. Lesson 23. Wisdom is knowing what to do. Virtue is doing it. A lot of us have a lot of ideas about autism. A lot of us sit around and speculate, and a lot of people tell other people what they should know and what they should do. I think the only way that we really solve the problems is by using the wisdom we have, working together, and doing something. It's not easy to be virtuous, but the time for us to do that is now. I guess I should quit. Thank you very much.
Before we get to the Q&A, first of all, on behalf of the department, I really want to thank Drs. Kim and Leventhal for what must be a very intense week. And it was really fascinating. I think this is, again, one of the virtues of what the IDEAS program has been trying to do. We've been out to the community, been here inside, and I think clearly what we've heard is the bar on this issue is clearly been raised. And I think that's really helpful, and I want to thank both of you for really a terrific week. One bit of housekeeping, because we're trying to record these grand rounds and get all of this set. Part of the Q&A issue has been people will just bring up questions from outside. What we'd like to do is have the microphones down up front. If you have a question, please come down, say it into the microphone. That way we can have a recording of it, and we can have the whole thing in a complete fashion. So just come down either aisle and ask whatever questions you might want to have. I'll start with one while people come down. One, I think you can stay right down that up. The material's been fascinating, and the heterogeneity is obviously without question. I guess what I kind of get to is how does, because psychiatry and psychiatric nosology has always been lumping versus splitters, how does the lumping help us find the needle in the haystack? Because in a certain way, by taking all of these different categories and putting them together, we're looking for a needle in a haystack, but we're making the haystack bigger. How do we go from there?
Well, so this is a perennial question. Actually, I have a piece I wrote that will appear in the Journal of American Academy of Child Psychiatry on lumping and splitting in December. Darwin actually struggled with the problem of lumping and splitting. Because on one hand, if you don't put things together, you can't find large enough populations or large enough groups to split. On the other hand, if you don't split things out, then you may not find characteristics that are specific enough to have an underlying biological or other kind of substrate. So it's always a tension in science about whether you lump or split. And I think and when you look at, and actually Victor Bukusic wrote a wonderful paper in the 1960s on lumping and splitting and said that, it's a trade-off. On one hand, you get a chance to find out genetic specificity when you split. On the other hand, you miss the fact that many genes may cause the same clinical syndrome. And so it's a tension up and back between the two. And really good science, you have to do both. So for some purposes, you have to lump. And certainly for diagnostic systems, for administrative reasons, but for some scientific reasons, you have to lump. But for other reasons, particularly when we're trying to find biological substrates of specific phenotypes, we have to split. And we have to split carefully so that we don't lose sight of the larger condition, the patient who has to live with it. And when we split so finely, then the human being who has to live with the disorder gets lost, and that would be a terrible tragedy, and you're responsible in some sense. But at the same time, to look at these kind of phenotypic substrates like social responsiveness or stereotypes, certain kinds of stereotype behaviors, is really probably the only way we're going to find some of the underlying mechanisms that are shared, perhaps shared with other disorders. It's got to do both.
Thank you. This is related to George's questions too, and I'd like you to elaborate on this. What about the type of study? I mean, for example, it's very different to do an epidemiological study when you are, doing interviews and you're getting blood and you can, really get and try to get as many people as you want and maybe lump as many people as you want and use a phenotypical, dimensional phenotype versus doing a study when you're actually looking at the brain. And what is available is, postmortem studies, and you've touched on that, or imaging studies. And imaging studies, you have to, you can't study 10,000 people. You can't even study 1,000 people. It doesn't mean that there may not be important questions about autism that can best be addressed by looking at the brain, and you're going to need to split. And how does that weigh into design and different kinds of research?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because I think it's an incredibly important question. And I, on one hand, you tell me what we have to do, and then you tell me why we can't do it. And it seems to me that the problem is that we must do something different. I've actually learned about this from my wife, who's an epidemiologist. I don't understand all this stuff that well. But here's the problem. If you do case control studies, which is an MRI study of 35 or 50 or 500 individuals, you get a set of results that are only partially useful. It's sort of like saying the score of the game was 5, and you have to figure out who won. You don't have a context in which to place it. And so the answer to your question is that we have to do both case control studies and population-based epidemiologic representative cohort studies. Because if you don't, you don't know what your case control represents or what it means. Now, there are ways to go about doing that. First of all, you don't have to image everybody out of 55,000 kids. But if you characterize and phenotype 55,000, and then you do a case control study that's representative of that 55,000, you can solve the problem. By the way, representative isn't likely to be 14 or 15 cases. It's likely to be several hundred. Secondly, the speed and cost of imaging, as an example, is changing rather dramatically. We just got a grant to actually scan 1,000 people across the age range. And we're putting this up as we scan them, publicly putting them up on the internet. And other people are sharing their data. This is exactly the same thing that's being done with genetics, where we're sharing genetic data and phenotyping data so that we'll now have large enough cohorts for case control studies, but it still doesn't obviate the need for having representative populations. And because you just can't interpret your data. In our example of the genetics, the epidemiologic study in Korea, if we had just seen the kids who had been identified clinically, which is the traditional way of doing a study, you go into, just say, we assume everybody who's got the problem comes to the clinic or gets help. We would have missed 2/3. Now, maybe it's not 2/3 in the United States. It might only be half or 1/3. But the point is, if you don't know the context, you don't know what a case control study means. And that's partly why findings don't get replicated, because you may do a study of 100 people here that you're imaging, and then we may do a study in New York of 100 people, and someone else will do them in Denver, and then you go to look at them, and they're not the same. And you're trying to compare them, and you say, why doesn't it replicate? And the reason it doesn't replicate is because you don't know the context. You can't put it together. And I think it's a real problem in science, not just in psychiatric research. It's across the board in medicine. I mean, it's why they've struggled in diabetes and asthma and cancer, because you don't have representative samples in which to appreciate what the small group you're looking at is and why they differ from the larger group. It's a dilemma that we face, particularly as resources decline, but I don't see it's a conundrum that we can't avoid until we actually have the epidemiologic data to characterize these populations in a way that'll be useful.
Oh, I beat you, Dr. Kassman. I beat you.
Go for it.
So I thank you. I was really curious about the stability of the diagnosis, that data with at the age 2, 5, and then I think at 9. And the children that dropped out of the pure autism but were in the spectrum disorder, was there anything specific about them? And I also wonder about, was there like a functional measurement in terms of did their functioning improve even though they didn't meet diagnostic criteria compared to the autism group?
Okay, so the reason that there's change over time is because we're not the same on any one day. You know, and so what you happen to see at one particular time within these using the ADOS. So, you know, so there's going to be some variability day to day. I mean, what didn't happen is kids didn't drop out of being in the spectrum. They may have gone from having autism to being an ASD, but they didn't leave the spectrum. And so it's sort of like saying, you know, one day your blood sugar is 400, one day your blood sugar is 300, one day it's 120, but, you know, you still have diabetes, you know, and so a single measurement really isn't that useful in terms of understanding the total of the pathophysiology, but it is useful in saying you're still, the measure is reliable and valid and sensitive and specific, but also that you largely are staying within a category, you're not moving in and out of it.
Thanks for a great talk. A question about what you were saying about hope at the end. When you said that individuals with ASD get better, Were you meaning that there's something about the natural course of the disorder that changes over time into adulthood, or were you talking about that we have potentially effective strategies to treat people, or both?
Terrific question. I'm sorry if I wasn't clear. A, people with autism do get better over time. They acquire skills, they learn to varying degrees, but they do. But the second thing is we now have treatments that increase that trajectory of improvement. So not only do we have reason to believe and know that people with autism do get better over time, they're not doomed to, you know, we don't have to lock them up and just assume nothing's going to happen. They do get better over time, but we now know that we can do things that not only don't interfere with them getting better, but actually can enhance that improvement. So their level of adaptive functioning, their capacity to live in the community and participate in the community more fully has grown almost as much as the prevalence has. I think it's partly because there's more awareness, more community acceptance, more availability of treatment services, clearly not enough, but But the notion that someone with autism can actually participate in the daily life of community is really important. They're on little league teams, they're on soccer teams, they're going to churches and synagogues, and they're welcome rather than being pushed away because people were afraid or didn't understand and thought there was no hope. So I think it's a combination of both.
Hi, I'm a student here at UNM, and I'm attending this as part of my class experience, and I wanted permission to quote you on some of the things that you've said in the paper I'm writing for the class, and then I have a second.
You can quote me.
Thank you. Thanks.
I'm being videotaped, so I suppose.
Right. Okay, and the second thing is, and you may know this, I just haven't seen it in any of the literature, is for Native American children, they don't do the pointing behaviors because they're specifically taught not to. It's extremely rude for traditional. And also when you're speaking to someone who you respect or an elder, you don't look at them. You look down, and that's showing respect. And that may be ingrained in their behaviors, and I don't know if that's taken into account. I've never seen it in any of the literature that I've reviewed.
So I think your question is extremely important and one that we've paid careful attention to in recent years. So is there cultural variability in human behavior? Yes. Are people with autism humans? Yes. Do they have cultural variability in their behavior as a result of the fact that they're in different cultures? Independent of them being autistic or having autism, the answer is yes. So the question one really has to ask is, does the cultural variability make it difficult for us to discern whether someone has an autism spectrum disorder? And the answer to that is no. So while you may not point, there are other things that are analogous to that people do that are part of the examination. So instead of pointing, you use your eyes to look, and you track each other's eyes. And so you may not look at the face of an elder, but do you look at the face of your peers? Or when you watch a movie, like I showed the Ami Klin's work, do you follow the faces? So I would consider it to be rather good news if someone with autism could follow the social norms in that culture, because it means they're more likely to be included and not to be shamed and excluded, but it doesn't mean that they don't have significant deficits that interfere with their general social functioning.
Thank you.
And that was quite sensitive. You knew the appropriate that they pointed their
eyes. It's a good guess. Okay, one more question.
Yeah, I'm an occupational therapist, and so I'm very interested in issues around the repetitive behaviors and restriction of interest. And it's always been, although autism's not a focus of my research, it's puzzling to me how little research actually has addressed, in particular, the restriction of interest. And I'm wondering if you know of some work that's been done in that area that I'm not aware of.
So, I do know that one of the Autism Centers of Excellence in Chicago, Ed Cook's, his whole focus is on insistence on sameness and understanding both the behavioral and biological substrates of that. And so there's actually been a great deal of interest in restricted and repetitive behaviors, how to assess them, what are the contingencies for them from a behavioral perspective. Some of the ABA programs are directed at them. There's actually been considerable interest, and there's been writing about it, both from the point of view of treatment, medications. Chris McDougall and others have done studies looking at the role of SSRIs in reducing restricted and repetitive behavior. And finding the biological substrate has been a really critical issue.
And I guess maybe I should make a distinction between the repetitive behaviors, you know, the stereotype behaviors, and the issue around interests, and particularly what I think there's a lot of potentially valuable work that could be done in terms of expanding interests in order to increase participation in the community with peers.
I think that so. I mean, maybe I'm not understanding your question, but that's actually a standard part of treatment. And taking, well, you start with even an ABA type of format where you're working at a desk and generalizing it to the community and broadening the repertoire of behaviors, because they often start in quite a specific narrow context, and how do you broaden them into other contexts is part of the challenge of treatment, but it's part of the treatment protocol.
Yeah, Actually, I'm not being clear in my question. So a more focused question for me would be then, have you seen that measured as an outcome in studies?
Yeah, some of the ABA studies use that as an outcome, generalization and participation.